شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان.
الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، my dear brothers and sisters in the community, I am making this video in response to some questions we have got. So I'm going to elaborate on these questions. They are really important questions, and they are coming to the minds of everyone right now. Examples of these questions are: when is Ramadan? Can we pray Taraweeh or Jum'ah online or through the Zoom or the Skype? How to make Taraweeh in such lockdown situation? You know, the masajid are locked up. And how many rak'ahs should we pray Taraweeh? And the imamah of women, can women lead the prayer, as well as also the young hufadh, the young kids, if they are excelling the qira'ah of the Quran. And one more mas'ala, which is the mas'ala of carrying or holding the Quran or reading from a reference during the salah. So inshallah ta'ala, these are some of the masail that I'm going to elaborate on it, inshallah ta'ala. To begin with the first mas'ala with regard to how to pray Taraweeh in home, it's very simple. Subhanallah, the situation as we are praying the fard in home, so we are going to pray Taraweeh also in home, same way. I want to say that subhanallah, some people are a little bit depressed or are taking it negatively, but subhanallah, you don't know, the masajid have are closed now, so our homes, there are so many masajids that are replaced, so many homes, so many families are praying in home, the adhan is being raised in home. So subhanallah, it has also some benefits and some wisdoms, and inshallah we'll go through this, inshallah we'll come out of this very very soon bi-idhnillah ta'ala. So I want to give you a little bit of brief about the Taraweeh. When was the Taraweeh made masnoon or made legislated in Islam? The first one to make the Taraweeh as something that is masnoon or something that is to be performed in the month of Ramadan was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. So the Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha narrates the story about this. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed Taraweeh for 3 and 4 nights, only 3 and 4 nights in Jama'ah in the Masjid. Alayhi salatu wa sallam. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left the Jama'ah and he would pray in home, in his room or in his home, alayhi salatu wa sallam, alone by himself, alayhi salatu wa sallam. And he mentioned the wisdom behind that, خَشِيتُ أَنْ تُفْرَضَ عَلَيْكُمْ. So that was out of his mercy and out of his compassion that he, alayhi salatu wa sallam, he just prayed it to make it as a sunnah in the masjid. He prayed 3-4 nights, and then Sayyidina Umar, it was his effort, radiallahu anhu, that he gathered the Sahaba and he gathered the people in the Taraweeh every single night in the month of Ramadan. And the name of Taraweeh comes from the word Tarweeha, means to relax and set for a rest between each two rak'ahs. So from this, brief about the history of the legislation of Salat, ومشروعية صلاة التراويح, it shows us that Salat al-Taraweeh is not something fard. It is something that is nafl, falls under the nafl, masnoon. It is a highly recommended sunnah or an act of worship to be performed in the month of Ramadan. It is very, very rewardable. But it is not a condition for the Salat al-Taraweeh to be in Jama'ah. So this is one of the things that I want to highlight. That is basically with regard to Salat al-Taraweeh. So it is something masnoon. So inshallah we're gonna pray it in home, inshallah ta'ala, the same way we pray and the brothers the community are praying in their homes. With regard to Salat, with regard to the how to pray it in home, how to pray the Salah in home, it is simply if someone prayed it individually, inshallah, with the intention and you will get the full reward of Salatul Jama'ah. Had, because Allah knows if we had the opportunity, you know, to pray in the masjid, we would have prayed Salatul Taraweeh in the masjid. So based on that intention, subhanAllah, you would get the reward bi'idhnillah ta'ala. Of course, if you can make Jama'ah in home, that would be great. That would be great if you can make a Jama'ah with your family members, right? And especially if there is a hafiz, right? If there is a hafiz to lead the prayer, or someone not necessarily to be hafiz of the full Quran, but at least half of the Quran, or any portion of the Quran. Another thing I want to highlight is that it is not a condition for the validity of Salat al-Taraweeh to make Khatm al-Quran in Salat al-Taraweeh. This is something that is really important. It is not a condition for the validity of Salat al-Taraweeh to be prayed in Jama'ah or to make Khatm al-Quran in the whole Taraweeh. So whatever, you know, you would be able to read in the Salat al-Taraweeh, you can read with that portion of Quran. So if there are Hufaz, that would be great if they would lead the Salah. And I, mashallah, we have, you know, some teachers, may Allah reward them. They taught Quran to so many young Hufaz here. So we have alhamdulillah, you know, plenty of Hufaz. They should do their best to revive the Taraweeh in their homes and lead their family members, their parents, and their siblings. And relatives in home. I would advise that we have to follow, to continue following the health and legal regulations, you know, the medical and legal regulations, because we are not yet fully covered from this pandemic. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove it away. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. So with regard to the social distancing and isolation and quarantine, it is something that was pioneered by the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. It is in line with the Sharia. So we have to isolate, we have to make a distance. So we shouldn't risk with having people, you know, who are not from our family members, you know, to pray in our homes. You have to be also respecting, you know, and following the guidelines. It was something that was actually, as I said, pioneered by the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam over 1400 years ago. The solution and the remedy, the cure of epidemic or pandemic is to isolate. And that's what the Prophet والسلام, you know, advised. And I plan to make a video for to highlight how the Prophet Muhammad والسلام, you know, as an evidence on his nubuwa and an evidence on his prophethood, he initiated and he established the modern idea of quarantine. So now coming back, so if there are hufaz, they should make the Salat al-Jama'ah in home for their families. For the sisters or the women, they cannot lead the Salah for men. They cannot lead the Salah. So if there are women, yes, a sister can lead the women, right? Can she make adhan and can she make iqama? There is a difference of opinion among the ulama. If she didn't make, you know, as long as they are women, if she didn't make, there is no issue. If she made, you know, she is following a view that some fuqaha discussed and some fuqaha allowed. So for women to lead men in salah, this is not permissible. Some fuqaha, they allowed a woman to lead a kids, you know, women including kids who are boys. So no issue with that. So that would be permissible as well. Coming back to the how to perform Salat al-Taraweeh in home, how to perform Salat al-Taraweeh in our homes. So now, it's if you prayed it individually, not in a jama'ah, that's very fine and the Salah is valid. If you can make a jama'ah, right, that would be great, okay? If the leader or the imam that is leading the Salah is someone who is hafiz, that would be amazing. Subhanallah, that would be rewardable and you would be able, inshallah, to make Khatm al-Quran. If you couldn't make Khatm al-Quran, let's make half of the Quran. Make, you know, one quarter of the Quran. You can distribute the pages or whatever you're going to read. If someone, you know, does not memorize, he is not hafiz of, you know, even Juz A'amma, what should he or she do? In this situation, you can read whatever you have in your mind. And something that you excel to read is better than something that you are struggling with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَقَرَأُوا مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. So read what is easy for you from the Quran. And this ayah was revealed concerning the Qiyam al-Layl. And subhanAllah, there is an amazing hadith. SubhanAllah, beautiful hadith. The hadith was narrated in Sahih Bukhari and Abi Sa'id al-Khudri. And rajulan sami'a rajulan yaqra. There was a man at the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and he heard a person who was reciting Qul huwa Allahu ahad, the chapter 112 in the Quran. Yuraddiduha, and he was repeating it in the salah. فلما أصبح جاء إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. In the morning he came to رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فذكر له ذلك, and he mentioned that to him. Subhanallah, he said, يا رسول الله, I was just reading قل والله أحد, and I was repeating it. وكان الرجل يتقالها, and the man was as if he was thinking it is something that is little, something that is, it is not much, you know, Quran, it's just, you know, a couple of verses he was repeating. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ إِنَّهَا لَتَعْدِلُ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ. Subhanallah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and by the one in whose hand is my soul, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ is equal to one third of the Quran. Subhanallah. So if you even just memorize قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ, قُلْ أَعُوذُ رَبِّ الْفَلَقِ, قُلْ أَعُوذُ رَبِّ النَّاسِ, whatever surahs, you know, 4, 5, 6 surahs, 10 surahs, you can read them and repeat them again. You can repeat them again, right? So there is no issue with that. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he prayed the whole night in Qiyam al-Layl with one ayah. And this is a riwayah in An-Nasa'i wa Ibn Majah. And Sayyidina Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu قال, قام النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بآية حتى أصبح يرددها. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he made Qiyam al-Layl with one single ayah, repeating it. So it is not about the, you know, the quantity. It's about the quality. It's about the connection, the khushu'ah, you know, something you will find your heart, you know, attached to, and you'll find attentiveness and khushu' in your heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكْ وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. So this was the ayah in Surah Al-Ma'idah, the last couple of ayat at the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah, chapter 5. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was reading the whole night, almost the whole night, with this ayah. Subhanallah. So you can repeat even the surah or the ayat that you memorize. Now, there is another mas'ala with regard to carrying the Quran or reading from a reference, reading from a tablet, reading from a cell phone, right? Is it permissible or not permissible? I want to make it you know, simple, and I want to also highlight the importance of imams and muftis. You know, it's a time, this is the time where we benefit and implement the mechanism of our early fuqaha and the leaders of the madhahib, when they would, you know, find, you know, the rulings and the concessions that would implement the higher objectives of the sharia and make the rituals easy for the people. Subhanallah, we need, it's a time now for the imams and the muftis and the ulama to implement the collective expertise of the fuqaha. Yes, with regard to carrying the Quran during the salah or reading from a reference, you know, there is a difference of opinion regarding this mas'ala, right? But we are to follow, you know, as long as there are some fuqaha who uphold, you know, this view, there is no issue with that. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, guide the ulama who don't, you know, explain to their people that, you know, effort and ijtihad within the madhahib, the considered madhahib of the ulama, Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi'i, Hanbali, and even the mujtahideen who came later, these are all scholars of sunnah. They all would uphold the shara of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the deen. So what the point I want to make is, there is a difference of opinion regarding this. And there are fuqaha who would, who wouldn't allow carrying the Quran during the salah, and there are many fuqaha who allowed it. So I give you examples. We have from the Hanafi madhab, we have got a group of fuqaha, including, right, or at the top of them, the two genius fuqaha and the close students of Imam Abu Hanifa himself. The Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, with due respect, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala radiallahu anhu arda, he would have hold the view that it is not permissible to read from the reference or from the Quran. But his two students, Al-Qadi Abu Yusuf and Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, they would allow that. Subhanallah, they would say This is an act of worship. This is a ritual that complement the salah. It is not something that is external of, you know, strange or something outside the salah. So from the Hanafi madhab, we have got Qadi Abu Yusuf and Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, right? From the Shafi'i madhab, they would allow that. They would allow to carry the Quran and other fuqaha from the Maliki and even the Hanbali madhabs. So what is where to draw the line? It is as follows. You know, there is a hadith or there is a reference or dalil in Sahih al-Bukhari that a person whose name is Dhakwan, he would recite to Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha from the Mus'haf. And based on that evidence or the dalil, the fuqaha, you know, they hold the view that it is permissible to carry the Quran during the salah, and this is not something that is amal kathir. It is not excessive movement during the salah. It is not a movement that invalidates the salah, right? So now to recap, to carry the Quran or to read from a reference from a tablet or from a phone, you know, is it permissible? It is. It has a difference of opinion. There is a respect with regard to the difference of opinion. We respect the scholars who disagree. Who don't view it is permissible, right? But there are fuqaha who allowed it, that it is permissible based on the riwayah, right? That Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha would have someone to lead the salah for her, and he would recite from the mushaf. So now, to make it easy, there is something which is, you can purchase a lectern or a stand to put the Quran on, to avoid much work or much movement during the salah. You can read from a tablet or from a cell phone, right? You can hold it, make a short stay. There is in the settings a smart stay where you can keep the screen. Make sure you are not, you know, distracted. You know, make it in air mode, plain airplane mode, and you can disconnect from the internet and also make it silent. So just make sure that there is no any distraction, and you can read from the phone or from the tablet. Maybe you can stand next to a chair, and when you go for ruku' and sujood, you put the phone or the tablet on the chair, and when you go up, you hold the Quran with one hand, and you put your hand on your chest with the other hand, or where you put it with the other hand. So, and you can basically, easily, you know, turn the pages or move the pages by touching the screen by your hand. You can do that based on this fatwa, and this many fuqaha allowed it. Right, so you can read from a mushaf. As I said, you can purchase the stand where you can put the Quran, and with one hand you can turn the page, and you don't have to read much. You can just keep the Quran like this, and in the two rak'ahs that you pray, you're gonna read one page and the second page, and then when you finish the salah, you will turn the page. So you're not gonna even move your hands if you have the Quran in front of you on a stand. And if the editor can show us the picture of that stand, and it has been one of the brothers, he mentioned that it is there in the Garden City, about $25 you can purchase it and put the Quran on it. So this is basically with regard to the Quran, with regard to Salat al-Taraweeh, that's going to be prayed in home. If you prayed it individually, no issue with that, it's okay. If you prayed it in Jama'ah, that's great. If you have Hufadh who can lead the Salah, that would be amazing. You don't have to, if someone doesn't memorize the Quran, whatever you memorize, you can read with. If someone wants to read from a Mus'haf or carry a Mus'haf or a phone or a tablet, you can do that based on the view in Fiqh, you know, that allows this. How many rak'ahs you are going to read? I want to say, I don't want to speak much about this because, you know, it is in Fiqh. Al-amru wasi', yani it is easy and flexible, right? There is leniency with regard to this matter. You know, some brothers, they take it very harshly, but they are not entitled to do this. So I would say those who used to pray 20 rak'ahs, carry on praying it 20 rak'ahs. Those who used to pray it 8 rak'ahs, or 11 rak'ahs in addition to the witr, carry on reading it 8 rak'ahs. But the point is, for those who pray it 8 rak'ahs or 11 rak'ahs, and those who pray it, you know, 20 or 23 rak'ahs, both are okay. There is no issue at all. You know, both are valid. Even if you prayed it 36 rak'ah, this is the view of Imam Malik. So the scholars, they say, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said salatul layli mathna mathna, the prayer during the night, or to stand in prayer during the night, or the nafl salah, right, is mathna mathna, two by two. فإذا خشي أحدكم الصبح, if someone fears that the fajr would enter, right, صلى ركعة واحدة, you will pray one ركعة, توتر له ما قد صلى, will make witr of the شفع witr, the شفع صلاة that you have prayed before. So the scholars they say, you know, the matter is very flexible. For those who pray 8 rak'ahs, it is permissible. For those who pray 20 rak'ahs, it is permissible. For those who pray even more than this, even, you know, 100 rak'ahs, it is also permissible. There is no limit with regard to the number of rak'ahs, and we shouldn't take it, harshly, or in a way that goes against the leniency of the Sharia and the Deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, with regard to the young huffaz, if we have a very young huffaz, right, can they lead, the salah for those who are adults? This mas'ala is also has a difference of opinion, and I want to make it simple as well, because we are in emergency. There are views in fiqh that allow, the young huffaz, as long as they are mumayyiz, the minimum age is 7 years old, and there is also ijtihad with regard to the age of tamyiz, discerning whether the child or the hafiz or the young hafiz is discerning, meaning he can distinguish between evil and good, he is mumayyiz, discerning kid. Even if he is not baligh, there is a big group of scholars who allowed that. And the evidence that they supported their permissibility, that a young kid who hafiz, who is, because ya ummul qawm akrahum li kitabillah, the Prophet ﷺ said it generally, that the one who is entitled, the one who is to lead people in salah, he is the one who is, best in qira'at al-Quran. So mashallah, you can find in some families they have young hafiz, mashallah, can they lead them in salah? Some scholars, they said no. There is respect, we respect that. Other fuqaha, they said it's okay. What is the dalil? What is the evidence? What is their wisdom? What is the objective that the other fuqaha, they allowed it? They say that Amr ibn Salama, Amr ibn Salama, he would lead his people in salah during the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That is basically, the evidence. They also respond to the other fuqaha who would use the hadith like رُفِعَ الْقَلَمَ عَنْ ثَلَاثَةَ, that the pen has been lifted from three, including عَنِ الصَّبِيحَ حَتَّى يَحْتَلِمْ, from a boy or a young kid until he reaches, the age of puberty. They say the salah is not, the hadith means that the salah is not wajib on him, but the salah is valid from him. So if a kid, a young hafiz, leads people in salah, the salah is not compulsory, but it is valid if he does it. So now, with regard to a young hufaz, they can lead the salah. They can lead the salah for the adults, based on the views of a group of fuqaha, and this is something that is in line with, the evidence that those scholars they quoted, that Amr ibn Salama, he was a young hafiz, he would lead people in salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward the fuqaha and the ulama who would make it easy for the people and for the Muslims. Now, coming to the issue that has been asked, we have got these questions, more than one time, a repeated question. So can people pray on follow online through Skype or Zoom? So look, there is ijma' in agreement, a consensus among the fuqaha, where there is a limit for the distance, from the followers or the muqtadis behind the imam. So there is ijma' on that, and they differ how much is the distance, right? But they all agree if it is a far distance and there are barriers, and the muqtadis or the followers, they can't see or they can't hear physically. Hear or see the imam, so this is not jama'ah, it is not valid for them to follow. So now, why, with regard to the contemporaneous mas'ala mustajadda, mas'ala mu'asira, this new emergency, that can people follow online? I would say they can't. Why? Whether in fard, whether in taraweeh. You know, the reason is, for with regard to the taraweeh, I said it is masnoon. It is something that is masnoon. So actually, the Sharia looks at the minimum level or that you know anyone can achieve. So basically, not all people have internet. You know, other considerations, the scholars would, I will share with you some of the reasons why it is not permissible to you know do this way of online following the jama'ah or the imam from home. The reason is the scholars, they say, you know, at the moment, you know, some contemporary scholars, they discuss the issues. And what I'm sharing with you is something that assemblies of fiqh assemblies and conferences are being, you know, have been discussing this masail. It is the time to benefit from all the legacy, you know, and the expertise of all of them, the madhahib. So I want to say that there is no one single madhab that is gonna sort a debatable issue in our time. There is no one single madhab that can help sort it out. So all the ijtihad and all the expertise of and the legacy of fiqh have to be utilized and benefited from. And this is actually implementation of the mechanism of the same principles that the founders of the imam would, you know, establish and would advise their followers to do. So following imam online is something that is gonna be problematic in so many, from so many, you know, aspects and perspectives. So what you wouldn't know are people behind or in front of the imam. So you wouldn't know that. You know, the masjid, where is the imam? You wouldn't know if there is imam or not. You know, it could be just something, you know, recorded or something. People may take it as zari'ah, as a means, you know, to always pray, follow, do this way. So even if, if this is not going to happen, you know, not all people having the luxury of internet. Internet can be interrupted and can stop any time, as we are seeing that and struggling, you know, with the challenges of, you know, recording and publishing online lectures. There are also, with regard to, there are many other ways, you know, the scholars say, people may be overseas. If we're gonna hold this view, you know, as long as it is live and people can see and hear the voice of the imam online, if someone outside Australia, according to this sense, right, so they can also follow the imam. So it's gonna be very, very problematic. So the conclusion is, it is not permissible. You know, the Sharia made it very easy. You will get the reward if you pray in home, right? If you could make a jama'ah in home, that would be great and would be better. Now to conclude with the last, with the last point in this video, when is Ramadan? When is Ramadan? I left it to the end of my talk. Simply, those who used to follow, those who used to follow the global moon sighting, or those who are following, for example, the Mufti in Sydney, the, for them, the Mufti has already announced, right, that you know, that Ramadan is gonna be on Friday, and they are gonna make the Taraweeh on from tomorrow, Thursday. And they also follow, you know, many, they follow fiqh considerations. I want to say that they follow reasons, they follow wisdoms, they follow evidences and tools in fiqh as well. So for those who would also follow global moon sighting, it is, you know, mostly, you know, or more likely they are going also to pray on Friday, based on also they take the calculation as a guide, right? So and it shows that the moon would be sighted as imkaniyat ru'ya, and there are many clues, you know, and the scientific calculation confirmed that it would be sighted. So based once the moon would be sighted in any part of the world, as the world has become, you know, an interconnected, place, you know, so it's like one body, you know, so they will be basically following the global moon sighting. So for them, the Taraweeh would be inshallah from tomorrow, once the moon would be sighted, and also the Ramadan would be on Friday. For those who follow the local moon sighting, so they will have to wait until the sunset of the 29th, which is tomorrow, and then Ramadan could be Friday or could be Saturday, based on that. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward everyone May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make a way out for us from this calamity and from this disaster. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to open the masajid again. So I have discussed in this video, the permissibility of praying in the Taraweeh in home. It is not a condition to pray it in a jama'ah. If you prayed it in jama'ah, that's great. It is not a condition to make the whole khatm al-Quran in the Salat al-Taraweeh. Whatever easy for you to read, that would be great. It is permissible based on the view of a number of fuqaha that it is okay to read the Quran from a mushaf or from a reference. You can read that. You can make khatm al-Quran from the mushaf during Salat al-Taraweeh. For women, they can't. It's not permissible for them to lead men. You can only lead women. Or some fuqaha, they said, if within the women, some kids who are male, that's also permissible. Young hufad, they can lead people in the salah. When is Ramadan? For those who follow local moon sighting, they have to wait, until the moon would be announced, sighted or not tomorrow, right? And those who follow the global moon sighting, more likely for them, the Ramadan would be on Friday. Allahumma balighna Ramadan, waffiqna fihi lissiyam wal qiyam. Allahumma asrif anna ma nahnu fihi min karb. Allahumma asrif anna ma nahnu fihi min bala. Allahumma aghfir lana dhunub, wastir al-uyub, wafarij al-kurub, watub alayna linatub. Subhanaka rabbi, subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, nashhadu ala ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.